So syntax analyzer creates the syntactic structure of the given source program. Okay. So it creates the syntactic structure of the given source program. The syntactic structure is mostly the parse tree. So what it does, what source code you write, it converts that source code into parse tree, because in the next phase you will have semantic analysis. The semantic analysis will work on your parse tree only. Okay. So syntax analyzer is also known as parser. Okay, because here the parsing is the main technique used to generate these parse trees. Okay. The syntax of programming is described by a syntax-free grammar called CFG. We will use BNF notation in the description of CFGs. So the syntax analyzer or parser checks whether a given source program satisfies the rule implemented in the context-free grammar or not. Okay, so how the syntax analyzer analyzes it? It will have a context-free grammar with it, and it will check, it will check your source code based on the context-free grammar it has in the background, and based on that whether all the instruction given in the source code are parsable or not. Okay. So if it satisfies, the parser creates the parse tree of the program. Otherwise, the parser gives you a error message. Okay. Now, a context-free grammar gives pieces of syntactic specification of programming language. The design of the grammar is an initial phase of the design of the compiler, right? So a grammar can directly converted into parser by some tools. So there are some tools using what a grammar can be directly converted into directly converted into a parser. Okay, so here you take your first assignment that list down at least three tools of CFG to parser converter and compare them. Okay. Okay. Now, how the communication between different phase with the parser looks like. So parser works on a stream of token. We understand that, right? Like this, you can see lexical analyzer we have already studied, and we know that lexical analyzer generates or sends a list of token to the parser, right? And same token is there in the symbol table. So parser, you can see parser can also communicate with the symbol table, and you can see that lexical analyzer is providing tokens to the parser. Okay, the smallest item is a token in the in a program. The smallest recognizable string is going to be called as a token. Okay, so source program, it goes to lexical analyzer. And you can see parser request for the next token. So there is get next token request function. When parser execute this function, a request comes to the lexical analyzer that you send a new token. And lexical analyzer sends a new token to the parser. Okay. And here you can see the outcome of the parser, output of the parser is a parse tree, which is going to the rest of the front end of the computer. So here the rest means here the first it will go to semantic analysis, right? Here it will, the first phase will be the semantic analysis. Okay, and the semantic analysis, after that there will be intermediate code generation, and that will generate the intermediate representation or intermediate code. Okay, so this is the concept how a parser is placed in the compiler, and how does it communicate with both of the side of of it, and what is its input and what is its output. Okay, so we categorize the parser into two types. One is top-down parser, another is bottom-up parser. So the parse tree, in case of bottom-up, sorry, in case of top-down parser, the parse tree is created in top to bottom. That means we'll start from the start symbol of the grammar, and we'll slowly go to the leaves. Okay, so in this direction. Okay, and starting from the root, so start symbol is always be at the root. Okay, in case of bottom up parsing, the parse is created from a bottom to top. So direction is from leaf to root. Okay, starting from the leaves. Okay, so this is the different two kind of parser we will go through in this chapter, and both top down and bottom up parser scan the input from left to right. Okay, that means if you have something like ID plus ID multiplication ID, so both the cases your read will be like this, left to right. Okay, now efficient top down and bottom up parsers can be implemented only for subclasses of context free grammars, like LL for top down parsing and LR for bottom up parsing. So these things we will see, that what is LL parsing, what is LR parsing, and all. Okay, now representative grammars with how they on this CFG, context free grammar, looks like. Associativity and precedence are captured in the following grammar. Okay, so if you use this grammar, and if you evaluate some input string arithmetic expression, the associativity and precedence of the operations are going to be captured. Okay, this is one good thing you can understand. Then similar to ones used previously for describing expression terms and factors. We have already used CFGs in previous in some of our one of our previous course. There we have seen it is quite similar with that. Okay, now representative grammars belongs to the class of LR grammar that are suitable for bottom-up parsing. Now, things that all the grammars are not suitable for bottom-up parsing. Some of the grammar are not suitable for top-down parsing. Top-down parsing and most of the grammar can be used, but if the grammar is ambiguous, then it will definitely give you problem. You have to remove the ambiguity. Okay, and this grammar can be adapted to handle additional operators and additional levels of precedence. Like in the additional operations means here we can add some operation like E minus T, we don't have here, right? Then we can have something like T divide A. So all these additional operation can be we can have here. Okay, it cannot be used for top-down parsing because it is left recursive. So what is left recursive grammar, that I will show you, and I will discuss in detail. Okay, now the same grammar in the non-left recursive form can be written like this. You can see here. Okay. So what is left recursion? Let me tell you. If the grammar head symbol is arising at the beginning of its body, then this is called left recursion. Understand? So if we have left recursion, we have to remove it. So there is a technique to remove, and after removing this left recursion, this is coming. I will go into detail how to remove left recursion and all. I will show you. Okay. Then syntax error handling. So there is a strategies like panic mode recovery and phase level recovery, right? So common programming error can occur at many different levels, like lexical error. We have already seen, and see, we have already come through the lexical analysis, which can detect error like misspelling of identifiers, keywords, or operators. Next, syntactic errors, like it in errors including misplaced semicolon or extra or missing braces. All these things comes under this syntactic error. Then comes semantic error, the type mismatch. Like many times you will find that error, like you are trying to divide multiply an integer by a float, or you are trying to assign a floating point number to an integer. So like you have say b equal to a, sorry. Okay, you have b, you are trying to do b equal to a, and you have previously written int b and float a equal to say 5.4. So what will happen? You will get an error that you are trying to store a floating point value into integer variable, right? So how this error came? So this error is called type mismatch error, right? So many of you are familiar with this term, type mismatch. Okay. So then logical errors, like assignment operator instead of giving comparison operator, dividing something by zero, all these are kind of logical errors. Okay. So goals of error handler, it report the presence of error clearly and accurately, recover from each error quickly enough to detect subsequent errors, and add minimal overhead to the processing to correct program. Now, what is parse level recovery? The parser may perform local correction on the remaining input, may replace prefix of the remaining input by some string that allow the parser to continue, or replace comma by semicolon, then delete an extraneous semicolon or extra semicolon if there is having some extra semicolon, or insert a missing semicolon. The choice of the local correction is left to the compiler designer. Whether the compiler, how the compiler designer build the strategy of doing the local correction. Because choose replacement that do not lead to issue like infinite loops. Because if the compiler designer thinks that, okay, I will use something, replace some substring to replace to make my parsing successful, and that can lead to some infinite loop, and not only infinite loop, that can lead many other problem to wrong output, unexpected errors and bugs. Many things can happen. Okay. Then error recovery strategies then comes to first level recovery we have seen, then errorness production and global correction. So do note that a closest correct program may not be what the programmer had in the mind, right? So by correction you can have some closest program, but it may not work or may not be same as what was the thinking or thought or for what the programmer had written the program, right? Then error production, it happens due to the grammar. So grammar of the language at hand with production that generate the errors construction. That means what input you are giving that is quite correct, okay, but your grammar is having some error in the production rules, okay, so due to that error is arriving. Okay, so in that case grammar should need to be corrected. Okay, then comes global correction. So algorithm for choosing a minimal sequence of changes to obtain a globally least cost correction. Okay, then given an incorrect input string AX and grammar G, this algorithm will find a parse tree for a related string Y, such that the number of insertion, deletion, and changes of token required to transform AX into Y is as small as possible. Okay, because if you by changing all these things, if there is many changes, maybe the meaning of the program will be different. Okay, so these methods are generally too costly to implement in term of time and space. So that is one of the main reason you'll find most of the cases error recovery techniques are not implemented in the compilers. Okay, then context-free grammars. We have an example here. If you see,